As mentioned, my talk will be about resistance training, which is within the area that I work with in my daily research, which is on exercise therapy and MS. I plan to start on talking a little about exercise therapy in general, then I'll move to resistance training, show some data from a Danish study, and then try also to summarize the international literature, and then finally summarize all into a short conclusion. But the strange thing about exercise and MS is that for more than 100 years, MS patients were generally advised not to participate in exercise. And this may sound a bit strange today, but of course there were some good arguments for this recommendation. One was that many patients worsened symptoms during or after exercise, up to 40%. However, today we know that these worsenings of symptoms, they disappear within 30 minutes in almost all patients. Another argument was that many patients suffer from fatigue, and thereby, by avoiding exercise, you could perhaps preserve more energy for activities of daily living. The consequence was that many patients, they had a more inactive lifestyle than the disease actually is giving cause to. And fortunately, many years of during the last 10 or 15 years, studies have started to emerge, showing that the application of exercise therapy is actually beneficial and also has some very nice and useful effects, and it has become an integrated part of much MS rehabilitation. If we compare an MS patient to a matched, healthy, controlled person, then we can see a lot of impairments. In general, the daily activity level is reduced, the aerobic capacity is reduced, muscle strength and mass is reduced, the functional capacity in terms of walking, stair climbing and things like that is often reduced, mood is reduced, fatigue is increased, and all adds up to impaired quality of life. Now, what can exercise do to this? Well, we do know that the disease process itself may lead to some physical impairments, but the disease process also leads to inactivity, and inactivity further enhances these physical impairments. But if we add exercise therapy, then we might have the chance to at least impact one of these pathways. Today, we don't know whether exercise has the potential to influence the disease process itself. We do have some very interesting animal studies showing that exercise may be able to at least slow down the progression of the disease, but we still need convincing human data on this aspect. At the moment, we are trying to put up a study looking into this in Denmark, but it's very difficult because you need to follow a huge group of people and control the exercise for a long time. That's difficult. However, what we do believe, and what I will try to convince you today, is that exercise can at least influence this activity or inactivity pattern, and through that change some of the physical impairments that are observed. But what is actually exercise therapy? Well, by definition, at least the definition that we follow, it's an individualized exercise prescription designed to restore health and prevent further disease and impairment. And this is often made by a doctor or rehabilitation specialists and takes into account the current medical condition and provides some specific advice regarding type, intensity, duration, and frequency of this exercise. But if we take this to a more practical level, then we have, of course, we have a lot of different exercise modalities. But you can put these into a line where we have, on the one end of the line, we have resistance training, and on the other end of the line, we have what we call endurance training or aerobic exercise. And these two poles are very different because if we take endurance training, when we do that, we do multiple contractions, but against low loads, our girl here is cycling, and every time she is pedaling, she's using the muscles, but the load is quite low. On the other hand, we have resistance training, where we apply a few muscle contractions, but every time against a very heavy load. And this actually gives some very different adaptations. But today, we'll look at resistance training, which is, as can be seen here, the one end of this line of activities. Let's look at some data from a study we did some years ago. The study was performed because we did this review, where we concluded that only few studies on resistance training and MS existed, and the methodological quality was in general quite low. So we designed a trial. We recruited 38 MS patients, all having a relapsing remitting disease course, and we randomized these into either a training group or a no intervention group. However, when you ask people to join a exercise study and they didn't tell them not to do anything, they get quite disappointed. So we afterwards offered them a 12-week resistance training period, looking exactly like the one that our exercise group completed. This design also allowed us to try to replicate the findings from the first part of the study, which we actually did. So the findings I will show you later on were actually more or less 100% replicated in our control group afterwards. But what we found was this is the changes during the first 12 weeks of the intervention, and as you can see, the muscle strength of the knee extensor in the exercise group improved by approximately 16%, which were significantly different from the control group. Also, we saw some functional improvements. We calculated this functional score based on two walking tests, one stair climbing test and one chair rise test. And the functional score improved by more than 20%. Also, we saw some improvements in fatigue score, in mood score, and in quality of life. The reason for the arrows going down here is that the higher the fatigue score, the more fatigued you are, and the higher the mood score, the more depressed you are. So actually, a reduction here is an improvement. But we saw, as mentioned, improvements in the exercise group as compared to the control group. So this led us to the conclusion that resistance training improves muscle strength, functional capacity, fatigue, mood, and quality of life in this group of moderately impaired MS patients. The EDSS score of these patients were between 3 and 5.5. However, what do we know from the literature in general? A few months ago, we submitted this review and when we did on resistance training and MS, and we localized five randomized controlled trials and three non-controlled trials, which we all included in this review. Then we performed this Pedro scoring, and what really came into was interesting here was that in these three items, 5, 6, and 7, which all concerns blinding, none of the studies applied blinding. So the general study characteristics showed that the Pedro score was between 3 and 7 on a scale going to 11, so that was not impressive, and none of the studies applied blinded assessors or tried to blind the intervention or things like that. Also, the EDSS score of these studies were all between 1 and 6.5, meaning that no studies included the most severely group of impaired patients. The duration of the studies were between 3 and 20 weeks. The frequency in most studies 2 times a week, but up to 5 times a week. And the intensity ranged from moderate to actually quite high in these studies. All studies exercised the lower extremity. Only one study included also exercise for the upper extremity. This may be caused by the fact that the lower extremity muscle strength is generally more impaired in MS patients as compared to the upper limb strength. All studies except one applied supervised exercise training, and as I'll show you in a few seconds, this supervision tend to increase the effects of training. So that, of course, also can be a bias. And then The sample size ranges from 8 to 38 patients, so it is quite small studies we are talking about here. But nonetheless, we think we could conclude some things from the existing studies. One thing was that the intervention was generally considered as a safe intervention. No serious adverse events were reported, and also no serious worsening of symptoms were reported in any of the studies. Also, the adherence was excellent, between 19 and 100% in all studies, which is, I guess, more than in most studies applying healthy people. Then we looked at the few studies that included the EDSS measure before and after a exercise period, and no effects was shown. This may be caused by the small sample sizes and the short intervention period, and also the quite low responsiveness of the EDSS measure. A general finding was that resistance training improved muscle strength. In these studies, it was between 7 and 21% for the knee extensors, the knee flexors, and the peak, the plantar flexors, sorry. So that was a strong finding, which were consistent throughout all studies. And then we also concluded that, at least in some of the studies, it was shown that resistance training could improve muscle mass and neural function. This is data from the study we conducted ourselves. We took out muscle biopsies from the vastus lateralis muscle, and after a period of exercise, the average fiber area of the muscles improved by 8%, and in particular, the type 2 muscle fibers, they increased their cross-sectional area by 14%, which actually is more or less the same as seen in similar studies from healthy people. So this study actually points in the direction that the muscle's ability to respond to exercise is quite well preserved, at least in response to resistance training. This is data from a Norwegian group that performed a quite short but intense resistance training study lasting 3 weeks with a 5-day-a-week frequency. What was shown here was that the neural activation of the soleus muscle was improved by 36% after only these 3 weeks of exercise. And again, this corresponds quite well to studies from healthy people where this neural adaptation is also quite common. So again, the neural adaptation system is not is still working, actually. Then the few studies that have looked at it, they reported improvements in self-reported fatigue, despite the fact that none of the studies focused or had this measure as a primary outcome, but this was consistently found. And also, at least a few studies pointed at improvements in mood and quality of life. And then, finally, the studies also showed that resistance training were able to improve gait function in terms of gait speed and distance and stair climbing and also chair rise, but these findings were not consistently shown in all studies. However, this is data from a meta-analysis performed by Robert Model's group, and here they focused on exercise in general and walking mobility, and they found that the mean effect size of an exercise intervention was 0.19, and if you only looked at the supervised exercise programs, this effect size went up to 0.32. And interesting, if you look at the mode of or the type of exercise, then resistance training was actually the one with the highest effect size compared to aerobic exercise and combined training. And then just finally to sum it all up, resistance training is a safe and beneficial training modality for MS patients, at least patients within the EDSS score below 6.5. And also it has the potential to improve both physical and mental functioning. And just to sum it up by using the figure from early on, then today we think there is quite good evidence showing that resistance training can actually counteract quite some of the effects of the disease as compared when you compare patients to healthy controls. And finally, thank you for your attention.